Now, let's turn our topic now to the brain, because all those challenges, whether it's linguistic or whether it's something as sort of motor skills like knitting and patterns and permutations, all test the brain's capacity to connect and to adjust as we are learning. Someone who can illuminate that wonderful grey space that we have between our ears, some 100 billion neurons, but who's counting, is my next guest, Professor Tony Hannan, who perfectly is the head of the Epigenetics and Neuroplasticity Laboratory at the Florey Institute of Neuroscience and Mental Health. Good evening, Tony.
Good evening, David. Great to be with you.
What is epigenetics?
So epigenetics, I explain, there's two analogies. So the first analogy is a musical analogy. So you think about the 20,000 or so genes as being musical instruments. Mm-hmm. And when you bring those together with the musicians, you then get the symphony of life. And so that's one way of thinking about epigenetics. The other way is thinking about epigenetics as this little book with 20,000 words that's within every cell of your body. And the words are there, but whether each word or gene is turned on or off or up or down depends whether it's italicized or bold or underlined or a different highlighter color. And that's what epigenetics is. It dictates whether individual genes in individual cells are turned on or off at different periods of life.
That is a thrilling definition, I have to say, Tony. And I'd imagine then, as you as being head of the epigenetics laboratory and neuroplasticity, it's about you trying to identify if there are any of those letters, any of those emboldened or italicized letters that may need just a slight adjustment. Is that the challenge that epigeneticists face?
Yes, that's a great question, and we're very much interested in that. I use the term epigenopathy, so that would be human diseases or disorders which involve disrupted epigenetics, and that's one of the things we're very interested in, the idea that if we can understand when epigenetics goes wrong, they may be targets for new therapies, including potentially new drugs or non-drug therapies as well.
Our topic tonight, amongst many other things, and the brain will always see us take tangents and divergence because that's the beauty of the organ itself. It is an absolute universe of mystery. But it is about the brain's plasticity, about the brain's ability to adjust and develop and reroute and sprout. Is that something that is constant, this sort of continual adjustment and retuning of the brain?
Yes, that's right, David. I think that's what makes the brain unique of all of our organs and biological systems, is the brain's really the only one that never stops developing. So it really changes throughout life. So whenever you learn something new, you actually change your brain structurally and functionally. So these 100 billion neurons you mentioned have about 100 trillion connections or synapses. And we think learning and new memories are a change in those connections. It's the connections that actually lay down memories and allow them to be restored, and learning, even like you said, juggling or physical learning involves changes in wiring in the brain as well.
So for Alison in Greensboro, for her at this stage, while lockdown is kind of prevailing, to be tackling biblical Hebrew as well as knitting socks, I'd imagine she's got quite a few different synapses, different neural pathways that are starting to illuminate across her mind as she's putting herself to two different disciplines. Do we know when it comes to different activities where the lobes, which patch of neurons are likely to be harnessed?
That's a good question. A lot of experiences and memories, it's very distributed over many brain regions. So there are regions very specific for language and for movement. You have a body map in your cerebral cortex where your surface of your body is mapped and so on. But a lot of experiences are sensory, and they're also emotional and they're physical. And so often a complex memory or complex skill is a bunch of connections distributed over many parts of the brain. So that's part of the complexity.
So the brain is continually adjusting. It's continually changing. The brain we're we're born with is not the brain that we have as a 10-year-old or as a 50-year-old. What influences see those changes take place?
Yes, that's a great question. And essentially, everything, I use this term environ, that would be your total environmental experience from conception through to old age, although we have other projects that suggest you can actually epigenetically inherit changes from your mother and father, both through while you're in utero, but also potentially through epigenetics of the sperm from the father. But even after birth, it's continual. It's cognitive stimulation, physical activity, sensory stimulation, but also other lifestyle factors like diet can affect the brain, including epigenetics and other factors like stress and sleep. So almost everything you experience can change your brain in one way or another.
Is the brain capable of regulating errors? If it senses as though there is an error in messaging, an error in the way a stimulus has been responded to, does it have the capacity subconsciously to make those intricate and subtle adjustments?
Yes, I think it constantly does that. The brain is almost a predictive machine. It's predicting how the environment's going to change. And we have to think of ourselves really as primates. We've evolved in a way. The brain has evolved in humans because it gave us selective advantage to deal with a changing environment. And that's also about predicting the environment and predicting changes. So our brain is always predicting what the world's going to be in the next second and the next minute. And that's a major part that it doesn't. And our brains are very good at detecting abnormalities and errors. That's one of the things that the brain's very good at.
It's 21 past eight. David Astle with you across three states and one territory tonight, New South Wales, Victoria, Tasmania and ACT. It's great to have your company. And I'm in company with Professor Tony Hannan, who's the head of Epigenetics and Neuroplasticity Laboratory at the Florey Institute of Neuroscience and Mental Health in Melbourne. We are looking at neuroplasticity, this ability for the brain to adjust, for the brain to make those sort of error regulations. And of course, when we are faced with challenges, Tony, whether it's in the likes of whether it's conditions we may have or whether it's through an acquired injury, this is where I would imagine where neuroplasticity comes into its own. You have done some study in particular with Huntington's disease, I understand.
That's right. That was one of our big discoveries. So before we made this discovery, which is about two decades ago, Huntington's was thought to be 100% genetic. So we know that it's caused by a genetic stutter in a single gene that is passed on to half the children in Huntington's families. But we did this work where we found that increased cognitive stimulation and physical activity, in this case, it was a mouse model of Huntington's disease that was used, and we're able to show that could dramatically delay onset of Huntington's disease. And with our colleagues studying the disease with Huntington's families, there's been evidence since then that this indeed does occur in Huntington's clinically. And so if a disease that was thought to be 100% genetic can be modified by the environment, can be slowed down by increased cognitive stimulation, physical activity, it really means that no brain disorder is 100% genetic. And in fact, no brain disorder is 100% environmental. Our genetics always affects the way our brains develop and respond to environment.
It's fascinating. What a great breakthrough that was. And also, too, what a broad horizon it presents. When it comes to helping someone who may have an injury that has been a result of a trauma, and they're trying to reconnect with the various parts of their body or overcome a cognitive shortfall, does the neural team identify what would be the activities that fire up the right places? And if so, how do they do that?
Yeah, so the Florey's strong in this area as well. rehabilitation following stroke, a form of brain injury, but also traumatic brain injury. And the idea is to have rehabilitation based on neuroscience. So you're trying to understand how you can optimize the rewiring of the brain to help those damaged bits, even if they can't really regrow some forms of damage like stroke. You do end up with a hole in your head, if you like, but to rewire the brain around that. So take the remaining brain and get as much function out of that as possible. And often these functions, when someone recovers from stroke, a function that was in that part of the brain where the stroke occurred, that function remaps to a completely different part of the brain. So in the brain of someone post-stroke or after traumatic brain injury, there's extraordinary plasticity as all of these functions can remap. Obviously, if the function doesn't remap, people can have long-term disabilities as well.
Darren has written in to say that I began doing cryptic crosswords a few years ago, struggling at the very beginning, and now becoming quite adept and stretching the neurons to often quite challenging ones. Including one or two that may be familiar to me. But are there any evidence to suggest that there are some activities that do kind of real salient benefit for the brain, whether it is doing something like a puzzle or whether it's juggling? Is there something that is actually very brain healthy, separate from diet, separate from exercise, but an activity or a kind of brain training action?
Yeah, certainly not a single one. And so the evidence isn't that a single type of software or a single puzzle or so on is much better than any other. But some of the commonalities are the complexity and the challenge and the fact that someone is learning. And you mentioned that you'd learned to juggle, and that's interesting. There was a study using brain imaging, this magnetic resonance imaging or MRI, and they took a group of young, undergraduates, university volunteers who'd never juggled, and half of them learnt to juggle over a period of time, and they imaged their brains before and after, and they could see physical changes at the level of this brain image, this MRI brain image, where they could see the parts in the jugglers that changed over time. It was actually extraordinary in that study to see that, if you like, that wiring changing, learning a new skill like juggling, which is obviously sensory and cognitive and physical. It's quite a complex activity. And so I think what the key is, a lot of this is really actually about trying to slow down brain aging, because we will all get Alzheimer's or some other form of dementia if we live long enough. All of our brains are aging, as are our bodies. And therefore, I think a lot of this is about how can we slow down brain aging and have healthier brain aging. And so it really comes down to activities that people enjoy, activities that challenge them, that they're learning, but they enjoy enough that they won't just do for a day or a week, but they'll do for months, maybe years, even decades. And I think that lifelong stimulation, doing things people enjoy, because then it's good for their mood, et cetera, as well, is very good. And complex activities like dancing, social interactions, very cognitively stimulating as well. So there's a whole range of things. So there's not one activity, and it's a very personal thing. But we all know there are some activities that challenge us more mentally than others.
Across the East Coast, you are being listened. You have listeners of people who are learning Hebrew. People are learning Russian, Scottish Gaelic. Do you speak another language, Tony?
I grew up with schoolboy French, and I wish I'd pursued it. And it's one of those things. I have lived overseas. I lived in England for 6 years, and in Europe, we had people who spoke 3, 4, 5 languages in the lab I was in. And so I was jealous of those who were fluent in 2 or more languages. And it's one of those things. I wish I was fluent in a second language. And it's never too late. I might actually try and become fluent. My sister's become fluent in Spanish and took that on later in life.
Oh, enhorabuena. I tell you what, reignite that French. But you are certainly fluent in the language of the brain. And thank you for sharing just one more insight, one more chapter into that wonderful, mysterious organ that we own for a... As you say, I love your idea of that kind of vast library where every little text, every little character has incredible influence on the way we think and behave. Really enjoyed the conversation, Tony. Thanks for joining me tonight.
So did I, David. Thanks very much.